18th of November, 1924.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
We were in a farm home, and we had a radio going on Sunday.
Right.
My dad was sitting there reading his Saturday Evening Post. I was just a young lad, and I was stretched out on the floor reading the funny papers. And all of a sudden, the radio broke in and said the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor.
Do you remember your dad's reaction?
He was always a staunch Republican. But when that happened, Dad got up and he said, from now on, everybody in this house will support Franklin Roosevelt. He is our commander in chief. I was drafted. I was going to enlist, but right at that time, they said, you cannot enlist anymore on your own. You have to go through selective service to get into the service. Camp Croft, South Carolina. We were trained for heavy weapons in the infantry. That was the heavy machine gun and the heavy 81 mortar. 10 days after graduation, I was in the Army. In Camp Croft, I was sent to Fort Meade, Maryland, and we began to get processed for going overseas. The 14th of December in 1943, on the 20th of December, our ship was anchored in the bay at Greenock, Scotland. We were put on troop trains and went south through England. It was a replacement center.
Mm-hmm, right.
Everybody went there, and there we were all broken up.
And that's when you got assigned to the 29th?
Yes, yes. Of H Company, 116th Regiment. Okay. Plymouth was our regimental headquarters. The 29th had been in maneuvering in the Moors, English Moors, and they had been drawn out of the Moors, and they were starting to do amphibious training out in the English Channel.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we did from then on, amphibious training. They never told us anything. We were never told anything for security reasons.
The Allied forces landed in France early this morning. I watched the first landing barges hit the beach exactly.
In broad daylight, the tremendous armada of 4,000 ships of all design, size, and shape began to move out of the British ports and across the choppy rolling channel. And at the appointed time, the Alsies moved on, many abreast, and spewed their men onto the beaches, the first to set foot on European soil since the tragedy of Dieppe.
The Le Milan draw on Omaha Beach.
Okay.
Now, we sent in two battalions, and the third battalion was in reserve behind us. The 1st Battalion landed at Vireville, and they were from, down in Virginia, Bedford. You've heard of the Bedford boys?
Yep.
Yeah, they were from Bedford, and that's where they got hit the hardest. The Germans saw them coming, saw our landing craft coming, and they held their fire, and they waited until the Americans' landing craft hit the beach and dropped the ramp, the steel ramp in the front, and then they fired their machine guns right into the landing craft. And that's where the Bedford had so many losses.
Right.
Now that was the 1st Battalion's objective. Our objective was the next valley draw west. It would be east at Le Malon. Now at Le Malon, we didn't have right away. We didn't have much resistance. We all landed. But what happened during the invasion, and the American commanders never had anticipated it, there was the tide run in and out. Then there was a riptide run along the beach like that. A lot of the landing craft were washed off course, going in. To make the invasion perfect, everything had to jive right, you know, just as it planned. If one thing failed, then everything else failed. We were to support F Company. They were going through the Le Malon, going up through the valley, supposedly. But when we got there, F Company was nowhere around. They had landed way over to the left. The riptide had carried them over. Of course, you understand, this was at 6 o'clock, 6:30 in the morning when they landed. It was dark. Good. I was in the heavy weapons company. We went in 30 minutes later at 7 o'clock. And F Company was not there. Well, the Germans had it. All during the invasion, the Americans, I don't think commanders realized how good the Germans were. In England, when we was getting ready to go, we had all sorts of maps. They showed us maps of where we was to land. A sand thing that's supposed to be like the invasion, made out of sand there, you know. And then there was aerial pictures. They had flown over and taken aerial pictures of the beach area before the invasion. They said to us, they said, now you see this right there on the beach, there's a three-story house at Le Malon. They said, when you come out of the sea, you look for that three-story house, that'll be your, that's what you'll guide in on, that three-story house. Well, we got there, the three-story house was there, supposedly, but it was not a three-story house. It was a very well camouflaged bunker.
Oh my gosh.
German bunker. And we went right into it. I was shot at by a sniper in that bunker. In that bunker was a communications, artillery observer, a sniper base, all their things was in that three-story house. They made it look like a home, just a regular home, but it wasn't. It was a bunker. I just got on the beach, and but we didn't know everything was wrong from what our officers had told us it was going to be. Everybody didn't know, and we lost quite a few of the officers and non-commissioned officers. I got down in a ditch right up next to that, just a little ways from that three-story house for protection. And some more people came and tried to get into the ditch, and I got up, I stood up to make room in there for them. And when I stood up, that sniper saw me and he shot at me. He didn't hit me, and I'm thankful for that, but he hit the bank right over beside me and threw dirt all over me. Well, our battalion commander, we were losing so many men. He says, we got to do something with that three-story house. We got to get it out of there. He sent up three patrols with hand grenades to get these people out of that bunker. And they got our patrols every time. So he called out to the Navy. The Navy ships were laying up and told him, he gave him the coordinates and everything, and he said, could they do anything? They called back and they said, we'll take care of it. They put a few rounds on that house and it disappeared. Right after I was shot at that time, the word came down. We said, F Company isn't here. G Company broke through down on the right. Now everybody moved down along the beach to where G Company broke through in Gwynn Land there. So that's how I was moving down, and I guess it was probably about 8 o'clock. One American tank was up there. It would go up to the sea wall and fire a few rounds, and then the Germans would try to zero in on them. So this tanker knew they was being zeroed in on, and he'd back off and go over and go in another place, and then the Germans would try to zero in on him again. But anyway, I went to go by this tank, and just then a German artillery round landed right behind the tank. They were trying to get the tank. They didn't get the tank, but I got my first Purple Heart. The round would have landed in front of me so that I'd got what blew forward, I probably would have been killed. But it landed behind me, and I got what blew back. And it was, I still got pieces of that artillery shell in my arm.
So you said that was your first Purple Heart?
Yes.
Where else did you get a Purple Heart?
On the Rohr River in Germany on Christmas Eve, 24th of December, 1944. We were waiting to go across the Rohr and across to the Rhine River. And we were on one side of the river, the Germans were on the other side. 30th Division had been with us on that defensive position, but then the Battle of the Bulge came along and 30th was pulled out and sent down to the Bulge. We were spread out along the river there, very thin. We would fire a few rounds over on their side, to their side. They would fire a few rounds on our side, and they got a lucky hit. I was out there, we had our mortar set up outside the house, and I was out there working on the mortar position, and they got a lucky hit, and two of us took shrapnel. I got it in both legs. Robert Hale from Baden, North Carolina was with me. He got it through his left leg, just above the knee. It went right straight through and took out a piece of meat like a piece of hamburger through his leg. But then the other piece hit him in the back. It was so close to the spine, the doctor didn't dare to operate on him. Yeah. And he carried that till his dying day, which is this last November. He still had that in his back. When I first got hit, I looked down there and I could see the cast iron sticking in my arm. It was in there. And all of a sudden, I began to break. I'm hit. Then Arden, what the hell is wrong with you? You can still walk, you can still navigate and everything. You're all right. Our field medic came along. I went and got to him and he bandaged it up. That field medic was a hero from forever. That is, I think, one of the reasons for so many casualties on D-Day. All we had was a field medic, and he carried a satchel. But he could put on bandages, he could give you a shoulder, morphine if you needed, or just a few things like that. He did save a lot of lives, but we had no, there was no hospital, there was no aid station or anything. The plan had been, I think, the hospital ship laid offshore, and they would come in and get the casualties and take them out to the hospital ship. But the way the invasion was going, they couldn't get in to get us. A lot of Americans were just laid there and bled to death. There was nothing the field medic could do.
That's your second Purple Heart, and then what happened there after that?
I was sent back to the hospital, and that time they weren't ever... the first hospital I went to was, I think, in Liège. But the Battle of the Bulge casualties started coming in, and it filled up, so they moved us on back. They moved us on back to Paris. We went into an American hospital in Paris. Well, that filled up. So they had American transport planes, those C-47s that the paratroopers used. Right. They had them stationed there, and they put us in there and took us back to England. And I was in England in the rest of the war.
This is the BBC Home Service. We're interrupting programs to make the following announcement. It is understood that in accordance with arrangements between the three great powers, an official announcement will be broadcast by the Prime Minister at 3 o'clock tomorrow. In view of this fact, tomorrow, Tuesday, will be treated as Victory in Europe Day.
After nearly 6 long years, the war in Europe is finally over. May 8, 1945 is declared Victory in Europe Day.
We started back. I was going back to 29th Division, and we pulled into Le Havre, and the war was ended. But when we got there, I knew something happened because everybody was just going crazy. The Americans, the French, and everything. Our ships, our warships laid offshore, and they were firing their anti-aircraft guns. They were firing tracers up into the sky. And they're just sitting there tracing. The French and the Americans both were just going crazy. And I don't know, I don't remember how, but somebody said the war was over in Europe and Germany had surrendered. So I never got into combat again.
Did you celebrate? Did you remember doing anything special? And
yeah, but that's a bad story. I don't care to repeat that very much.
Oh,
I was on guard duty.
Yep.
Me and this, we had this, and you don't need to put this in there.
No, I'll take it out.
Our replacement company was set up in a company, you know, and set up. Well, there was a second lieutenant that had just got out of OCS over here. He was going over there and make himself a hero so he could tell his grandchildren what he did in World War II. Well, World War II ended before he got it, and he wanted to do something. Well, then, so we were doing guard duty. This young kid and I was walking up and down past doing guard duty past this little cafe. There was Americans and French in there, and they were drinking and having a heck of a time and everything. I said to him, you know, it wouldn't do any hurt. We had just a little drink. The war is over. And I didn't think it'd do any hurt. We went in there even 10 minutes. Back, kept walking our post back again. The next morning, this company commander called me in. He said, I checked your guard post last night. You weren't there. Where were you?
Gotcha.
Uh-oh. Arden, you've had it. He said, you know. I told him exactly what happened. He said, you know, you've had the Articles of War. And you know what the penalty is for violating your guard post in time of war. Hanging or firing squad. I didn't care so much. I knew Fort Leavenworth, I heard they paid you pretty good. But what am I going to, well, what about the folks back home? What are they going to think? I was feeling lower in a snake's belly. I didn't know what I was going to do. All the way through the war and two Purple Hearts and everything, and then I was going to end up in a stockade. Well, that night, we're sitting there in a tent, and this first sergeant came in. He was an old army man. He had been through North Africa and Sicily and all that, and he'd gotten wounded bad, and so they wanted to give him just, they didn't want him on a frontline unit anymore. So they sent him a first sergeant in this replacement company. He came down. He didn't say very much, but I could tell from what he did say, he hated this 7 day or 94, this second lieutenant. He finally said, "What outfit were you with?" And I said, 29th Division. He said, 29th Division's up at Munster, Germany. He said, "Soldier, there's a truck out here. It's going up to Munster tomorrow morning. You get your ass on that truck and you get the hell out of here and don't you ever look back." And I did, and I never heard no more. But I didn't even go to breakfast the next morning. Yeah. I went out and got on that truck and waited, and we took off and we went up to Munster. And I served the rest of my time with the 29th Division. They were sent to Bremerhaven, north, the Bremerhaven enclave. What was happening there, our trains were going through Europe. We was unloading our ships at ports in France and Belgium. The trains would go through Europe. Well, when the train would pull off on a siding, the civilians would break right into our boxcars and steal American goods. Of course, they were poor. They hadn't had anything all during the war, but there was a heck of a black market going on in Europe right then. And they could, anything they could get that was American, was they'd sell it on the black market. Well, Eisenhower decided we had to do something about that. So we negotiated with the English, and up in their zone, we got this port at Bremerhaven. And we went in there, we relieved as a, I think it was a 151st Scottish Highlanders were stationed there, and we relieved them.
And what was the reunion like when you came home?
They didn't do anything. No.
Yeah.
Union City, I mean, they'd been so much store, they'd been through so much and everything. They were just glad it was over.
Yeah.
And I was a little disappointed in my hometown. I got off the train, took a walk around through town. I saw one flag, American flag, being flown over the city building, and that was all.
Okay.
I went into the restaurant and got a little breakfast and a cup of coffee, and I said, "What happened here after on VE Day?" He said, "Nothing." Well, maybe I got the wrong impression of it. But when we were in the occupation, we were in the occupation there 6 months. And we practically lived with the German people. And when you come right down to it, they were just like Americans.
Mm-hmm.
When American boy was killed overseas, his mother over here cried when she heard about it. When the German boy was killed in war and his mother heard about it, she cried. So what's the difference?
Right.
I mean, we all got a, and those German people were so much like Americans. We got along good with them. My outfit came from Martinsville. My company came from Martinsville, Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I heard all the time I was over there, Martinsville. So I went back. Just before the invasion, we were given extra recruits. We had about 100 in the company then. Today, there's one.
Okay.
They're all gone.
Yeah. Well, you're special. Thank you for sharing your story. That's just terrific.